thank you for joining us this evening for something. While we've done things like this similarly in past years, we've not quite done it this way before, and that is to reach out to the Evanston community to get their thoughts and input on the preparation of our budget. The city has a calendar year budget. We are working on the fiscal year 2017 budget right now, and annually we have an event to get information from the community, get feedback from the community prior to my submitting a proposed budget to the Evanston City Council this year. That will be on October 7th. So while we have done this in the council chambers with a smaller turnout over the last few years, we thought we'd try something different this year, and that is a two-hour telecast where we will talk about the city budget. We will have our senior city management here to talk about their departments and answer questions. But we're asking members of the community to submit questions to us in a whole variety of ways. First of all, we have several hardy folks here with us at the Lorraine Morton Civic Center. So we have cards for them to fill out. And so if they have questions, they can put those on a card and we will address them. We also are encouraging folks to join us on Facebook. We can be found at facebook.com/cityofevanston. We're also asking people to follow this meeting on Twitter. We're live tweeting it at cityofevanston2. I liken it to where you have ESPN and ESPN2. Well, we have our regular City of Evanston Twitter feed, but we also have one for special events. So we're using that tonight, cityofevanston2. People can call us at 311. Our 311 center is open this evening. So if you have a question you'd like answered, you can just call 311 and have that answered. You can also send an email to us at 311, and you could ask a question through that. We have the ability to take Spanish questions. We're going to be using our Spanish Twitter feed tonight as well. So if there are questions submitted in Spanish, we will deal with those as well. So. Again, our purpose tonight is to share some information, to receive some information, and hopefully as we work toward the preparation of our fiscal year 2017 proposed budget, which will be presented to the council on October 7th, the input that we receive tonight will be helpful to us in that. So to get us started, I'm joined, first of all, by Marty Lyons. Marty is the Assistant City Manager of the City of Evanston. He is also our Finance Director, as well as our Chief Financial Officer. Marty's responsibility with his able staff is to prepare the proposed document. And I've asked Marty to start us off this evening with sort of a brief overview of how we spend our money citywide and some of our current operations. So Marty, we'll start with you, and I'll say good evening.
Good evening, Wally. Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone, and thank you for joining in. Tonight, we're going to start off as if you don't know very much about the City of Evanston or the City of Evanston's budget. And this is in keeping with how we also, in many respects, prepare our budget. We try to prepare a baseline budget so that folks understand what are our standard services, and then talk about things that change. So tonight, we're going to establish a baseline of understanding for the city, and then talk about where we're at. We will have breaks during the presentation. At about every 10 slides, there's going to be a break, and you'll be asked if you want to ask questions. And we are going to go from the very general, the demographics of the city, to financials, to department financials, to revenues, to capital programs. So we will hit just about every part of our budget process. But that doesn't mean you have to be too patient. If you have a question, make sure you get it asked. So thank you very much for attending, and I'll get started. So I just referred to that. So, you know, the city is, we are in Cook County. We are a home rule unit. Home rule means that we have the authority to do certain things as long as they are not restricted by the state of Illinois. A classic example is we have a home rule sales tax, and that means that it's not designated by the state, but it's also not prohibited by the state. So we have certain home rule authority. Our powers are established by the Constitution, and we are a council manager form of government as opposed to a mayor council, where the mayor would be the chief executive in the city of Evanston. The city manager is the chief executive. our census is growing, and while you see there that it dropped a little bit between 2011 and 2014, we're projecting closer to 76 to 77,000 in population due to a lot of new developments. 8 square miles and 33,000 housing units. I won't read all of these to you. I think what's important to look at is that infrastructure. A lot of people don't realize how many miles of streets and sewers and water mains that must be maintained. Our departments, we have several departments, police and fire, 165 sworn police officers. And when we'll go through this a little bit more in the departmental portion, so I won't belabor this too much. But we are a full service community, which means we have police, fire, public works, water, sewer, parking, and parks and recs. You will quite often find municipalities that are in a fire district or have a parks district or have a library district. We have all of the services under one umbrella, under the municipal umbrella in Evanston. And again, I think it's definitely worth noting one of our issues for our capital program is our parks and recreation capital and infrastructure. So 265 acres and 75 parks, a lot to do. I mean, many community centers that all are staffed and need upkeep. And then also our municipal water utility. Many folks may not know we provide water to David's 400,000 total or 400,000 residents in many communities, including the city of Evanston. So, and that is not the full capacity of our water plant. So our budget. Some communities are still on what's called an appropriation, and they do that after the start of the year. We do a budget, which you must have done before the beginning of your year, and that budget must cover all of your funds throughout the city. So we also include policies, so how much we should have in reserves, what we should do with our tax levy, how our funds should be spent. And our budget is, as you can see tonight, it is a tool for communicating with residents. So it's not just the printed document. It's also our process. Our process is how we involve residents in the budget and in the planning of our resources for the coming year. So fund-based budgets, this is unique to the governmental sector, but it's not unique just to the United States. It's in other countries as well, but we break expenses into funds, and you've heard, for instance, the state's general fund is $11 billion in the hole. Our general fund is not in the hole, and that's where we have our police, fire, public works, community development, and parks and recreation and health, as well as community development. All of those operations are inside the general fund. We also have a variety of other funds, which we're required to have when we provide a service for a fee. And that's how the service is paid for completely. We're required to set those up as enterprise funds, so water, sewer, solid waste. So that's our, and we're moving more towards an environmental view of our solid waste fund. And of course, we have also have a parking fund, which many communities don't have, but parking is very important in Evanston. And then finally, we have a capital improvement fund. And that is a creation of capital improvements. Used to be a part of general fund, but you would see general fund spiking every year, and nobody could predict what would happen. So we broke out the capital into another fund. That way people can see operations versus capital. Again, these are other funds like our E911 fund. That's a special revenue, but it's not a fee. It's a tax. So we have to account for it separately. And then finally, we have funds to track all of our bonds. We also have what's called internal service funds. So if all departments need a certain service, such as health insurance, we create an internal fund to track it all together so we can monitor it and someone can very easily see how much did the city spend on health insurance. It's in one place. And finally, the police and fire personnel are covered under local pension funds. Civilian personnel are covered under the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund, a statewide fund, but we have two trust funds that track the assets and liabilities and payments for pensions for police and fire personnel. So our current policy for our general fund is that we have 2 months' worth of reserves, and we're below that right now. So this budget is going to try and move us back towards that level to get us back up to 16%, and that is for two reasons. One, we have better credit ratings, and two, we're able to respond in the event of an emergency where revenues could be interrupted. We still need public safety, and we still need public works staff to be able to respond, so we need a small reserve. And this is the minimum amount recommended by a Government Finance Officers Association. And finally, one of the things that we debate every year is how much of our revenues are one-time versus ongoing revenues, and how much should be devoted towards operations versus capital. These are policy issues that we look at every year in the budget process. I won't read this to you. We're right before where we're talking with you before we start moving toward the council receiving the budget in October. That gives the council just under 3 months. They need to pass it by the end of the fiscal year, which is December 31st. So we have multiple meetings, and we, at the end of this presentation and on the website, we have a budget calendar. That was very quick. So if we have questions, we're happy to take them at this time.
So we've been soliciting some questions, and Alex Thorpe with our finance division is sort of the question man. And I know, Alex, you had a couple of initial questions. I think one was specifically dealing with the fire department. And as I think many of you are aware, our fire chief, Greg Kleiber, retired last week. And so our police chief for Jeddington is supervising the operations of the fire department. So I think I'll ask Chief Eddington to come up. We'll see him again in a little while and talk more in depth about police and fire issues. But Chief Eddington, good evening. The first question I think came to us as an email. And the question is, I saw in the last budget meeting there was $300,000 spent on overtime pay for firefighters. Wouldn't the benefits to hire new firefighters to cover the overtime expenses and have more manpower outweigh paying overtime to current positions, especially when we're approaching the winter season? What if more current firefighters get injured? What if the currently injured won't return to work? So clearly we want to make sure that our fire department has what we call constant manning, or a continuous a group of folks here. So what can you tell us, not even a week in as the worrying about operations of the fire department, about how overtime is used?
Well, let me first thank management analyst Mike Whalen for getting me up to speed and giving me the answers to these questions. That was really important. I think there's the two parts of this issue. One, I will punt to Marty, who will deal with the long-term pension ramifications of additional hiring. This current overtime situation that the fire department finds itself in is based on some injuries to firefighters. There are approximately 6 firefighters that are injured. 5 of those firefighters are expected to return to work shortly. What would happen if we would overhire to cover these short-term events would be a difficult pension issue, which I'll let Mr. Lyons address. In the short term, it's more workable to expend the overtime funds with our experienced personnel that are familiar with the city of Evanston, don't need to be trained, and are currently fluent in Evanston firefighting and EMS operations. And so this management decision was made by the retired fire chief, his command staff, in conjunction with the city manager to address this short-term manpower issue via overtime.
Great.
And just to follow up on the pension side, one thing before that, the total overtime for fire is still below 10% of the regular pay. So if you get up above 10 to 15% of your overtime costs of regular pay, that's a benchmark to look at of whether or not we're working current staff too many hours. So we are still at that 10% level. So think of that on if this was an 8-hour shift, that would mean one overtime shift every pay period, not one every week, so it's one every 10 days. They work 24 hours on, so it's a little bit different situation. With regards to the pensions, all police and fire pensions are based on base salary. So if you have a firefighter who works 110% of his wages his whole career, he will still only get a pension on 100% of his final pay. If we hire another firefighter, we have an entire another pension to cover. So from a pension perspective, it is much more cost effective to have one less person. Now, if person's point is well taken. If one of our firefighters is injured and goes out on disability pension, that is a cost. So that, as the chief pointed out, it is a balancing act, and I think we are in balance.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
Let's do one more question, and then we'll continue with the presentation. We have a question from a member of the audience about the Robert Crown Project, and I'll let Mr. Lyons answer this question. To this individual, they ask, who will be the staff member to run the Robert Crown Project? And it appears to the individual asking the question that the city is understaffed. Mr. Lyons, why don't you maybe just briefly talk about what we're doing with Crown and the current status of that and how we're currently staffing the project.
Thank you. Right now, this is a project that, compared to most of our projects, hasn't even started. Most of our capital projects, the first time you would hear about it is when we're going into design, because whether we're doing a street or looking at one of our facilities for routine capital improvements, we would budget for design, then budget for capital. And we've been talking about the Robert Crown Project since about 2002. It had a hiatus for about 8 or 9 years, and then we started again. And we're still in, right now, we have an RFQ out to pick an architect. Once we get to the point of having an architect and hiring a construction firm, we will have to have additional staff. We will have to have, whether you want to call them an owner's representative or someone else on staff, that will monitor the construction of the facility from start to finish. I'm here to monitor the project as we get funding in place, as we get our people hired, and then monitoring the overall project. But my expertise would not be putting on the hard hat and heading out to the new site. We will have folks educated and experienced in that job once we get to that point. So I believe we will be properly staffed at each step of the way and not too soon.
All right, let's move on then to the department structure. Maybe the next slide, Marty. 10 operating departments. We've done some reorganization from time to time. Last year, we reorganized the city manager's office so that the finance division moved from the administrative services department to the city manager's office. We moved our facilities and fleet operations from public works to administrative services, and then did a fairly large reorganization of our public works and utilities departments, reorganized them into a public works agency, so those remaining divisions were there. So as we talk this evening, we're going to talk a little bit with each department head about that. An important part of the city is not a department run by an appointed official, but rather a department that is managed by our elected city clerk, Rodney Green. And Mr. Green is here, and if you wouldn't mind maybe just coming up and talking a little bit about the budget of the city clerk. The mayor and city council have a modest budget which covers their salaries and some miscellaneous expenses, but Clerk Green is responsible for an operation that is here every day, five plus days a week, it seems. And so, Mr. Green, welcome. Thank you for coming this evening. Maybe you could just talk a little bit about the makeup of your department and the dollars associated with this, and really anything else you care to share about that.
All right, welcome to be here. My department consists of two full-time employees. We have started this year, initiated where we have we've basically changed our hours to accommodate the residents who need to come in after 5 o'clock but can't get there before we close. So now on Tuesday, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, we open until 6 o'clock p.m. to allow for those folk to come in. Our finances right now have increased some because we also doing passports right now. So for those who need passports, we do supply that service for you as well. As for, and gotta forgive me because I just had my eyes dilated, but with a lot of the revenue that come in, we don't gather enough, we don't gather too much revenue, because most of our revenue comes in and goes back to the collector's office, because we are the pulling up, we pull in the funds, but we, it's credited over to the collector's office. What we do now is also allowing those who are selling property, we're now taking on the form of if they have to pay the water bill, they can pay with us in the clerk's office instead of waiting in line to pay at the collector's office. That way it gives the seller and the buyer easier times to get in and out in selling their properties. And I think with that, City Manager, I think it's all that I can give you right now.
Great.
And you also remember, election is coming up. So those who are running for an office, make sure you get your petitions in.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Clerk Lee, for joining us tonight. I think it's important people, you know, understand the critical operations your department provides the city. So thank you very much for coming.
Thank you.
Next is the City Manager's Office. Mr. Lyons and I have the privilege of managing those operations. As you can see on the slide before you, the budget at $71 million, Mr. Lyons.
I'll be happy to address that.
That's a pretty big budget for 28 people. How do we account for a $71 million budget in the City Manager's Office?
Thank you for that easy question, sir. Traditionally in cities, the finance department would be the recipient, the receiver of all general tax revenues in the general fund. So the property tax would come in for the general fund and sit in the finance department or the sales tax. And now the finance department is inside the city manager's office. So you'd see $71 million in revenue, and that is for all non-department specific revenue. So what's a non-department, or what's a department specific revenue? Mark Munzer, who's here tonight in the community development office, has more than, it's about $11 million in permit revenue that's listed in the community development budget, because it's his staff that monitors all of the building activities in the community, with the exception of a right-of-way permit, but monitors all of those. And so the revenue is listed in his operations. So our total revenues in the general fund, if you recall that, is about $111 million, 71 of which would be deemed general revenues coming from taxes, non-specific fines that aren't a part of a department, fees and interest income. I'm trying to think of all the ones that I may have missed, but for the most part, about two-thirds of that is property taxes, sales tax, income tax, general taxes received by the general fund. And then our expenses, I'm going to jump into that and just say that our expenses are approximately $2 million for the finance division. Then we also have other divisions as a part of the city manager's office, as well as expenses that are distributed citywide. For instance, there's a $200,000 contingency for the $100 million general fund. So that's 0.2% is set aside as a contingency in case something happens during the year. Well, that's in the city manager's office, and it then could be moved to any budget if it's needed. And as noted on the slide, we do have a lot of activities in the city manager's office, and I won't read those to you specifically, so we keep ourselves moving.
But I think we can cover in general terms. So in addition to the finance division, so that's payables, receivables, the general accounting function, our budget function. This was all within the finance division, the economic development division, four staff members there who report to Mr. Lyons, our community engagement division, which is four staff members, three staff members now, as part of that, four staff members, the community engagement manager corrects me, the assistant to the city manager, Kimberly Richardson, our sustainability manager, Catherine Hurley, our cultural arts coordinator, Jennifer Lassick. So cultural arts, sustainability, community engagement, economic development, finance, all parts of that. You would go to most communities and would find those functions scattered about in various places, probably not in the city manager's office, but it makes sense, I think, as Mr. Lyons has indicated, that we do that here. All right. I don't know that we've had any city manager questions. Alex, I think there was one about the city manager's spending authority. And did that come from someone here in the audience?
Yes.
So a resident here in the audience said, please explain to me the under $20,000 rules that allows city employees to spend money without council approval. Please explain what controls you have not to misuse the funds. So the city council of the city of Evanston has to approve every expenditure over $20,000. Expenditures under $20,000 may be approved by me as the city manager or our department directors or the deputy department directors, depending on the size of the expenditure. So I think the question speaks to oversight. Regardless of how the money is expended, all expenditures come before the city council in what we call a bills list. In some places it's called a check register. Marty, where else have you heard it called?
A warrant list.
A warrant list. So every check that the city cuts is listed in a report at the beginning of every council agenda. So those checks are held and are not paid until the council reviews that check register. We go even one step further. We have a number of employees in the city who have credit cards. And so we also publish at that same council meeting, or actually it's once a month, I think, is the credit card transactions.
Right.
Every credit card transaction. So as a resident of Evanston, you can see every check that we cut, as well as every time a city credit card is used. So that is good oversight. The city council receives that information usually a day or two before the agenda packet goes out, so they have an additional time to ask questions. There are questions asked every week. We then have staff that put together the answers to those questions, and they're made available to the city council. So the $20,000 threshold is a pretty standard one. It has been $20,000 in Evanston for a long time.
And it's also a statutory. So this is at the Illinois. You'll find this level.
It's a maximum.
Yes.
So there may be communities that have met them smaller.
Correct.
So the oversight is, you know, my oversight as the city manager to make sure the departments are spending the money correctly. The city council reviews those expenditures. And again, fortunately, we've not had a lot of trouble with that. What I think does trip some communities up, though, is those credit cards, and that that there are many communities who probably have much more greater use of credit cards than number of credit cards per employee that we do. But they're very useful, and we have lots of people spending lots of money with credit cards, and we feel very strongly, and I know of no other community, certainly in the Chicago area, that publishes the list of all the credit card transactions as well. So I think that provides some additional scrutiny. So answers.
Technically, in some communities you would find one line item, $150,000 paid to the Bank of America. That's our credit card vendor, and that satisfies the legal requirement. But instead, we have a separate listing of all of the transactions that go off to that credit card company to be paid. So that's an extra step.
Great. Let's move on to our departments. Next is the Law Department. Grant Farrar is our Corporation Counsel. Grant's been with us, 7 years. That's right. It's an anniversary date even coming up pretty soon, isn't it?
Yes.
So Grant is the Corporation Counsel. He is the city's chief legal officer. So Grant, good evening. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Wally. Thank you, Marty.
Maybe you can just tell us a little bit about what a municipal law department does, and then maybe talk a little bit about the number of folks that you have and your budget.
Well, we have four attorneys besides myself in the law department currently, and each of them have their distinct areas of responsibility, which include defending the city in all claims brought against it in court or in other venues. We also have attorneys that work on ordinance drafting, advising counsel to the various departments and various staff of the city. So it's a very robust and vigorous privilege and honor to discharge on a daily basis to support the city and support its policy goals and support the city council and their policy goals. In terms of our budget, we also have the Administrative Adjudication Division and the Liquor Licensing Department, which has a revenue-based component, but our budget is relatively stable. It's only, I think, 1% of the city's general fund.
Wow.
So we're kind of the small fry compared to other folks. But what we do with that money and what we do with that budgeted expenditure is primarily geared towards supporting staff, as a lot of our costs really don't show up on a balance sheet because we have the privilege of being able to represent the city in-house as opposed to farming cases out of house, which is what the vast majority of municipalities in Illinois do. So you have outside council costs, which we do not have in the city.
So maybe talk a little bit about that, because obviously anyone who deals with lawyers know that it's an expensive business having lawyers. Why does it make sense for the city of Evanston to have, and it's on a percentage basis, what, probably 90% plus, 80% plus of the number of cases that we'll handle internally, because certainly we do use outside counsel mm-hmm. for some things.
Sure.
Why is that a good thing financially to have that inside counsel?
Well, that's an excellent question, and what I can do is answer it in two parts. I can take you back 7 years and indicate to you that when I came on board and when the council decided to take a fresh look at this, they saw that almost every case on a litigated instance, in a litigated basis, was farmed outside, and the law department handled no cases. So there were 30 cases when I came online in 2009. Our current case
load. Were there not lawyers on staff?
There were.
Okay.
They just didn't handle litigation for many reasons. So what the council and you and Mr. Lyons indicated to me as my charge was, wouldn't it be great if we could bring some of that work or most of that work in-house, build a trial team? And that's precisely what we've done over 7 years. And so two things. The caseload has gone from 30 to right now it's approximately 15. And that is a very, obviously, a big decrease, 50%. And also, the outside legal fees are correspondingly much less. Now, the one outlier in this, and I see that there's a question on it, is the James Park environmental matter, which is a situation where we're litigating against three downtown law firms that are staffing the case with seven attorneys per side, so we have the benefit and the correct determination to use outside counsel to support us in the litigation on that effort.
Now, from time to time, I guess the law department's not successful and there are claims against it paid. Can you maybe give us some perspective? What might the city have been paying out in claims 6, 7, 8 years ago versus what more of the trend has been over the last few years?
Well, there is a dedicated fund in the city budget outside of the general fund. It's called the insurance fund. And when we came online, we had, I believe, and Mr. Lyons can correct me if I'm wrong, we had $9 million budgeted as reserves for exposures, for claims payable in 2010. Right now, I believe that we have budgeted approximately $2.5 million. So you're talking about a very steep decrease. And in terms of the tort payouts, with the exception of one or two in the last couple of years, our tort payouts have been very low. And our litigated record from June 2015 to June 2016, pretrial motions, summary judgments, trial verdicts, we were 20-2.
One last couple questions dealing with maybe the part of the law department most people don't know about, and that is administrative adjudication and the work that we do supporting the Liquor Control Board. Can you talk a little bit about
sure.
those two functions?
We have a statutorily created entity called the Administrative Adjudication Division, where the police department and other entities, the health department, can write citations that are heard on the second floor here in the Civic Center. And they usually are local ordinance violations, can be seatbelt tickets, can be nuisance premises tickets. And what we do is we will collect revenue if the judges do find, make a finding of libel. We do collect revenue in those instances if a libel finding is entered on the record. We also have a very ongoing, busy liquor licensing scheme, because thankfully through the good work of the Economic Development Department, we have lots of entities that want to have restaurants and have a liquor selling component. So we work with the local liquor control commissioner, who is the mayor, and work with her and the board there to create licenses to generate the revenue under the city code for those activities. So it's a very interesting process that continues to evolve as different business models come to the city.
Great. All right. Well, Mr. Farrar, thank you. Appreciate your time. Appreciate the work the Law Department does.
Thank you.
We're going to move on now to our Administrative Services Department, Erica Storley. In addition to being the Director of Administrative Services, she's also the Deputy City Manager. And so, Erica, welcome this evening. We're happy to have you.
Hello. Thanks for having me.
So, Administrative Services has gone through changes, quite a bit of changes. When I arrived as city manager in 2009, there wasn't an Administrative Services Department. So maybe you can talk just briefly, you know, how did we get an Administrative Services Department? What has it contained perhaps in the past, and what are the component parts to the department today?
Sure. So Administrative Services, like you said, hasn't been around all that long, and it's evolved as all things do. We've figured out more ways to refine it. It is an internal service department, so we're providing services to the internal department so that they can better do their jobs. Right now, Administrative Services includes parking, facilities management, human resources, information technology, and fleet services. So cars, buildings, infrastructure for technology, all of the above. And our budget, I think we have up there, is a little over $9.5 million this year. And revenues, as you can tell, are going to be down a little bit. The biggest reason for that is because parking ticket revenue is down. So because we have new meters that are taking credit cards and people are using the Passport app, which lets you pay for your parking through your mobile phone, we've seen a major increase in compliance with people paying for their parking. Parking meter revenue itself goes into the parking fund, which is why it's not reflected in this budget, but parking meter tickets and other assorted tickets do go into this budget, so that is why you see the decrease on the revenue side.
So let's talk a little bit about each of these component parts. I mean, parking is a very big deal in Evanston. We have surface parking lots, we have parking decks, parking structures, we have the meters, we have the boxes like at the library parking lot where you pay at that. What does it take to operate parking operations in the city of Evanston?
Parking operations take a coordinated effort between not only just our department but other divisions in the city. There's a meter collection staff who go around and collect the revenues from the meters.
So that means just people actually go and empty out the meters and take out the quarters?
Yes, people still use coins in the meters, and we will always allow that. But like we said, the large majority of people are now using the credit cards. It's more than 50% of our revenue is coming in through the credit cards now. Additionally, we have maintenance staff that takes care of the garages. We have an outside company that operates the garages for us. And then we have the parking policy side of the equation, which is also a large amount of what we do, because parking is always a changing operation with new buildings being built, people moving into different parts of town. We need to look at district parking and see if there's different things that need to be tweaked to make sure that everybody has what they need to be able to park in their neighborhoods, close to businesses, allowing for retail operations to thrive, etc.
So you're saying that parking meter revenue is going down?
No, parking meter revenue is going up. Parking tickets are going down.
Ah, so why do you think that is?
As I touched on a little bit before, it's mostly because people are paying for their parking the way that they're supposed to. When they go to eat at a restaurant or go to a movie, they're paying the meter. When they go to park to go to these fine restaurants and establishments that we have in Evanston, when we are getting people that aren't compliant, that's when we put tickets out, and that revenue is down because more people are doing what they're supposed to be doing, which is great.
So let me turn to Marty Lyons. So Marty, this doesn't sound good. You know, we've depended on those meters, people not being able to run and put the coins in and getting tickets. Well, give me a sense of what financial impacts that's had for the city over the last couple of years.
The financial impacts have been that parking revenue is slightly down. And whenever we would have someone come in and say, I'd really love to come in and pay my fine, which is not how they come in, but when they come in, quite often, if we have a good discussion, we say, our goal is not to collect fine revenue, our goal is compliance. And we're getting to live it, where we've dropped by 20% on our parking fine revenue, which is a lot for the general fund. So
from a dollars and cents standpoint?
Oh, I don't know. We're probably going to be down $200,000 to $300,000 for the amount of fines that are lost compared to the new meter revenue brought in. And unfortunately, as Ms. Storley pointed out, We will be looking at shifting some revenues because the meter revenue comes into the parking fund and the fines go into the general fund because that's where the PEOs, the parking enforcement officers, are located. So we'll look at that from a whole parking system perspective, but the net is that we'll have less parking revenue, but we're more than happy with that because that could mean more sales tax revenue, that there are people shopping. We could have a lot more going on in all of our business districts. More businesses coming into town mean higher property values. So this is a very good thing, the situation. And that was our best case scenario when we presented the electronic meters to the council about 2.5-3 years ago, that this is something we wanted to see.
Another big part of what you do is fleet services that had been a part of our public works department for a long time when we reorganized. Can you give us a sense of what challenges we face in the fleet? How big is the fleet? What kind of vehicles do we have in our municipal fleet?
Sure. So fleet services is a very important part of all city operations, from street sweeping to garbage pickup to snow plowing. And all these operations require the use of equipment that is very costly to both purchase and maintain. We have a very skilled mechanic staff that keeps these equipment in their best operating function, but for the most part, we're kind of behind on replacing these a lot of vehicles in the fleet because after the recession in 2008, we kind of cut back on the amount that we were replacing on a scheduled basis just so that we could continue to fund all of the other operations. So as the economy has recovered, we've started to chip away at a lot of those overdue purchases and make good purchases so that we can keep the quality of the fleet up to speed where it should be. But we're getting to a point where that's more stable, and that's a good thing because the staff will spend less on repairing the equipment. But overall, the equipment itself is getting better. We're looking at more alternative fuel vehicles. There's options for grants and funding for things like natural or electric garbage trucks we're looking at right now for recycling pickup, things like that.
We heard from the Corporation Council about internal lawyers versus, external lawyers. With the fleet, you would think, gosh, can't we just go down to Dexler Tire and have all of our fleet issues happen? So why do we have City Forces doing it? Do they handle all of our repairs? Are some of them contracted out? How do we handle all that with the vehicle maintenance?
Well, it would be nice if we could employ Evanston businesses to do a lot of this work, but unfortunately, due to the nature of the equipment that's being maintained, it's not possible. The fire trucks don't fit into a lot of the bays that are available in all the stations in Evanston, and a lot of it is specialized. So your everyday regular person working on transmissions isn't going to know how to fix a garbage truck or things with lifts and all that kind of thing. So a lot of the work is done in-house for repairs, but a lot of it is also gone to vendors who specialize in maintaining the specific type of equipment that we have. A lot of our vehicles come with warranties when we purchase them, so when they're in warranty, they go back to the manufacturer to maintain that warranty. But when they get out of warranty, we do some repairs at Evanston-based businesses or other businesses outside of the area that may specialize in the type of equipment being repaired.
Well, you have our human resources division that does, I think, very traditional kind of human resource work. Our IT group, again, very talented, does a lot of different variety of things. The last part of your department I want to talk a little bit about from a cost perspective is facility maintenance. Can you give us a sense of sort of the breadth and depth? Obviously, the Morton Civic Center is a big piece of what we maintain. Tell us a little bit about the scope of what our facility maintenance staff does.
Facilities maintenance staff has a tremendous responsibility to maintain all the buildings that the city owns. Currently, that portfolio stands at approximately 45 properties. Some of the newer acquisitions include the Gibbs Morrison Cultural Center. We maintain these buildings with a set staff of 22 full-time equivalents. That's not a lot of people to maintain that many buildings, but they do a great job and they're very skilled and talented. The operating budget for the building maintenance is approximately $800,000, which is a good amount of money to do preventative maintenance and things like that, but it's also, we're working in tandem with the capital improvement staff to make sure that capital improvement projects go smoothly, and we're evaluating all of the buildings all the time for maintenance needs and future capital infrastructure improvements. Additionally, this year we'll be doing some work on the Harley Clark Mansion to get that property online before next summer so that we can run the summer camp program out of there. That was recently discussed at the City Council last week, so we'll be working on that starting probably next week.
That's great. I don't see any questions, Alex, for Administrative Services. Are we having any other general questions at this point we can put up, or are we're waiting for the departments to come up? There's one for Public Works, so. Well, very good. Well, Erica Sterling, thank you very much for joining us this evening. Give us an insight on Administrative Services. Our next department is going to be our Community Development Department and Mark Munzer. But let me just recap why we're here and what we're doing. This is the City of Evanston's budget outreach meeting. We're asking community members either to join us here at the Morton Civic Center or contact us through a whole variety of means, either through Facebook or Twitter. Call us at 311, email us. So we would appreciate your questions. We have folks here in the audience submitting them, but we're not seeing a whole bunch of questions, unfortunately, coming from other means. So if you're sitting at home tonight, really want to get involved in talking about municipal revenue, municipal budgeting, we would encourage you to do that. But our next department we're going to talk about is our Community Development Department. Mark Munzer is here. Good evening, Mark. So nice to see you.
Likewise. Good evening, John.
Mark, you've been here how many years now as the department director?
A little over 3 years.
And I know you have other municipal experience. I mean, you worked in a city just to the south of us. What's the name of that city?
I can't recall it. It's Chicago.
Chicago, that's right. And what did you do in the city of Chicago?
I managed the Zoning Board of Appeals and the city's planning commission.
So you have some background then in dealing with land use issues and quality of life and community standards.
I like to think a little bit.
Tell us a little bit about what your department here in Evanston does, a little sense of the budget, and then we can talk maybe about some more specifics.
Sure. So it's three different divisions. It's building and inspection services, so anything related to filing for a building permit for new construction and subsequent review of that permit. And then we have a group of inspectors who conduct over 6,000 inspections a year in the community to verify that construction is code compliant. The second division is planning and zoning. So any land use entitlements, any change in the use or the zoning of the property is reviewed by that division. They also review all building permits to make sure they're zoning compliant, and they deal with historic preservation issues. So any development in our historic districts or to landmark buildings. Third division is housing and grants administration. So they deal with our federal entitlement dollars, which are predominantly CDBG. And they administer that funding to a variety of different community organizations that administer services to low and moderate income populations. They also work with outside entities to develop affordable housing opportunities for Evanston residents. And then we've recently added a fourth function, which is transportation and mobility. And that is dealing with our friends at CTA, Metra, RTA, and PACE to make sure that Evanston stations and rail and bus infrastructure is addressed, any issues that may come up, and then working with them on improvements to that infrastructure.
That's great. Well, looking at the slide we have on revenues and expenses, boy.
I like Mark's department.
Yeah. Something's going on here. So,
that's a good
so,
year.
So you're estimating to have revenues by the end of this year, fiscal 2016, of $11.2 million and expenses of $2.5 million. So are you selling lemonade, or what's going on here?
I was happy to see that slide. So people are interested in being in Evanston, both in renovating existing buildings and also in new development. So these numbers are a reflection of a good economy and a good market in our community. They're also a reflection of the amount of activity at Northwestern University as we realize building permits from their developments, their new projects, and also they're doing many renovations. So it's really, we split it up between three ways. There's a baseline amount to this revenue source that is your traditional development. Then we also have had approval of planned developments, which are the larger hotels and apartment buildings. Some Northwestern projects are part of that. And then you have the Northwestern piece.
So let me go over to Marty Lyons. So Marty, building permits, a big part of what this budget's all about. When I look at the budget versus the year in estimates, nearly $2 million to the good. give us some more perspective on building permit revenue. What have we seen over time? Are we seeing big years in the last couple of years? Is this sort of normal? And how do we deal with it from a budgeting perspective?
This is much higher than we've had in the past 8 years, and we do have later on slide that we can put up where in 2010 we were at 1.5 million in building permits, so almost 10 times the building permits that we had.
So in 6 years we've gone from $1.5 million to what we're estimating to be over $7.5 million. So well, that's a $6 million increase?
Yes, sorry. I was looking at the whole permits, and yes, so you're correct.
So how do you budget for something like that? How as a city, does that mean we get to hire lots more staff because of the $6 million? Is it something that's going to continue forever? You know, I think that, you know, we're looking at a slide off camera here, which shows that in 2011 it was 2.2 million, 2012. Do we have that to put up, Alex, by chance?
I can go to it.
Okay. Hold on. Why don't we go to that? Because I think this is an important part of our budget, especially when you consider the financial challenges we've had as a community over the last several years, what we've actually had to spend, what we've actually received in building permits. So we're skipping ahead here. I apologize, but...
And if I can add, Wally, there are additional permits related to building permits. So you have HVAC and electrical and plumbing. Those are separate permits. So that also is a revenue source that is above and beyond that 7.5 million number you're looking at.
So that's a very big deal.
But to answer the question, what we look at is each year we try to establish what would be deemed a baseline. As Mr. Munzer pointed out, we have certain levels of rehab permits for homeowners who are redoing their houses. We have certain levels of permits for new construction. And over time, we average those to establish a baseline, and then we move that baseline, but not by the entire amount of any given year's increase. So if you're doing investments, you call it income averaging. We call it's a revenue averaging. We don't want to take advantage of all of the revenue that we might see in 1 year. But the city, conversely, has also when these permits last year, for instance, we thought we would have a lot come in, and they didn't come in right at the end of the year. They're coming in this year. So we didn't reduce staff because a permit was late. We used our reserves. And so one of the things that we will use the building permit revenue as it comes back in is to replenish the reserves back to our 16% that I referenced earlier. The other thing that we can use it for is for one-time expenses for capital purposes. Or for development, so that we keep on with new development. If we continue to have good development that meets the city's goals, then this revenue can stay at an optimal level. So, but I would say we have our baseline, and that's for all services, because while Mr. Munzer's budget was only $2.5 million, those permits also help pay for police and fire and all of the folks that are responsible for maintaining the safety and of those buildings and everyone that's in those buildings. So we do share the building permit revenue with our basic service departments to cover their costs.
One other issue I want to cover, Mark, about the Community Development Department, and that is the Community Development Block Grant. So we receive funds from the federal government annually to support some city operations, some other operations. Talk a little bit about CDBG funds and how they're expended.
Yes, so they are federal dollars, and they are administered. The city has certain public services that it provides that is funded by CBG and certain facilities, again, that benefit certain census tracts in low and moderate income areas. And so we use those dollars to make improvements such as at Foster Field and some other projects that we've had recently. We were able to use CDBG dollars. And then we also have a competitive process with local organizations, local nonprofits that provide a wide variety of services to the community where they come and make presentations to a Housing and Community Development Act community or committee, and our staff evaluates those, the committee evaluates those, and then they make an annual allocation to the different organizations for specific projects or programs that, again, benefit certain communities.
That's great. So I don't see any specific questions for the Community Development Department. I'll say thank you for your service. Thank you for all you do for Evanston, and thanks for coming out tonight.
Happy to be here.
Again, we're here talking about the proposed fiscal 2017 budget, trying to get input from folks. I would encourage those of you watching on Facebook and following us on Twitter to be able to do that. Oh, Mr. Munzer, we have a late question that's come in through Twitter. The question is, what are we doing to put affordable housing funds to work and bring affordable housing units to Evanston? That's a tremendous question.
Wow, that is a tremendous question. So a couple of different ways. So we have an affordable housing fund that has about $1 million in it. Its source of revenue is through demolition fees for residential buildings and also contributions made by various developments to the fund over the years that have built large developments, and as a way to give a public benefit back to Evanston, have contributed certain dollars. So we have that ability. And then recently the City Council, effective January 1st, passed an inclusionary housing ordinance. So what that does is any development of a certain size, and that's most developments between 5 and 10 units and up, is either putting on-site affordable units in the building that meet a certain area median income level, or they're contributing at $100,000 per unit to the city's affordable housing fund. So we are now going to fortunately be starting to realize additional revenue into that fund, and we are working to develop a plan to, if a developer is not creating those units in a new development, then how we're going to create those with various community organizations. So we're excited.
So my sense is that there's been frustration in the community that we're collecting money and not spending it.
Mm-hmm.
And certainly we have been talking internally about what we might be able to do for 2017, and I would suspect in the proposed budget for 2017 we will likely have some new initiatives.
We will.
Give me a flavor of perhaps some of the things we're talking about, in, at least in general terms, that people might see in that proposed budget.
Sure. So we've looked at it from short-term housing needs, medium-term to long-term. So short-term, that would be possibly using a voucher-type program to accommodate individuals that may be between a lease, may have had a situation that has resulted in them not having availability of housing, but they will have something in a couple weeks. So we would have a program where we would qualify them and potentially provide a payment to get them into a bridge-type housing. Also, medium-term, so we would be looking with our community partners to possibly have leases in buildings where, again, where people were in between places and could be documented that they were eligible for this assistance, that we would be able to put them into what we call medium-term housing. And then the last one is again, looking at sticks and bricks, if you will, in developing actual affordable housing developments similar to Emerson Square that recently opened a few years ago.
Great. So I think it's fair to say that there'll likely be some movement in our proposed budget in these areas.
There will be. We're very excited about it.
Great. I don't see, Mr. Thorpe, any additional questions, so we'll let you go. Again, thanks very much to Mark Munzer, our Community Development Director. Next, I'd like to ask Rich Eddington, our Police Chief, to come up. Again, we're live here at the Morton Civic Center this evening talking about our proposed fiscal year 2017 budget. You're certainly welcome to join us here. It's a little before 8 o'clock. We'll be here at least another hour. You're welcome to come down to the garden level of the Civic Center or join us via Twitter, on Facebook, carrier pigeon, email, whatever it takes. I'm sorry? 311. We certainly are looking forward to your questions, and we thank the folks that are here in the audience with us tonight. So Chief Eddington, good evening.
Good evening.
Police Department, a big part of what we do pretty much on every measurable level. You've been here now just short of 10 years. It'll be, what, 10 years this coming spring, I think, in March.
Yes.
As the Chief of Police in Evanston. Really so many things to talk about. I think really to talk about just the scope of the department, maybe talk about the number of police officers you have, the number of officers that are out on any given day, protecting the residents of Evanston.
Thank you. It is a large and complex city, and consequently we need a large and complex police department to maintain the safety inside the city. The average patrol shift fields 13 officers per shift for 8-hour shifts. Our shifts run from 7 to 3, 3 to 11, and 11 to 7. In addition to those 13 officers, there's usually a minimum of two supervisors. In addition to those patrol units, they're backed up by the detective division, the juvenile division, our neighborhood enforcement team, and our tactical unit. Those allow to address specific crimes and address crime patterns that are related either to primarily gun-related crimes, especially the tactical unit and the neighborhood enforcement team. Also, the problem-solving team is an integral part of policing in the city of Evanston. These officers are assigned by ward throughout the city to work on long-term issues in conjunction with their aldermen. I think that they are not call-driven. They have the time to address issues in the community, and as a short-term way of saying this is that not all police solutions end in handcuffs. They have other options at their disposal, and work very hard to bring solutions to the communities that always don't involve arrests.
So we look at the slide, 225.5 full-time equivalent positions. The vast majority of those are sworn. Is that correct, Chief?
166 of those positions are sworn. The rest are in our records division, 911, and service desk. All those are civilian components of the police department, plus our administrative staff that handles the payroll budgeting. And once again, I need to thank management analyst Lou Gerges for preparing this budget, which is large and complex.
We live in an area that has a lot of complex law enforcement issues, being just adjacent to the city of Chicago. Just today, Mayor Emanuel announced a plan to hire a fair amount more police officers, probably another two Evanston police departments to add to the complement of CPD. So as we're looking at budget issues, you know, for the police department, there's so many aspects to what we need to do to fight crime, and I think people's really only one of those. Maybe you could talk a little bit more about, you know, issues we're facing moving forward with technology, issues we're facing with other equipment needs, because I think a lot of people would say, oh, if we're going to make Evanston a safer place, let's just hire police officers. And that's not necessarily quite the tack that you've had or the Evanston City Council has had. So maybe talk a little bit more about how all that works. I know if we gave you more police officers, you'd say thank you. But as far as other kinds of resource needs that we also have to look after at the police department.
Yes, between my tech and the City Council's tech, I think that's their tech is much more important. But seriously, our personnel are very important to the crime suppression activities. 90% of the police department budget is tied up in personnel costs. But it's not just enough to throw more manpower at a situation. You have to give them the right tools. If you look at the slide on the screen, we talk about upgrading the computer-aided dispatch system. This is a program that 911 coordinator Perry Polinsky and his staff have worked tirelessly on. Men and women inside the police department have provided training to other members of the department to get this system ready for its go-live date of October 4th. This will provide a wealth of information that will allow us to vector our resources into the hot spots that we have found over time by the use of our deployment program to suppress crime. As a matter of fact, Part 1 crime in the city of Evanston is down 17% year-to-date this year. That translates into 225 less victims. That's a huge impact on the quality of life in the city. And so we look at those issues that allow us to be a force multiplier via technology. The CAD system is only one example. The use of the laptop computers in the squad car is also another one that makes that recording of police activity, documenting that police activity, much more usable and pours that data into our crime analysts to make the decisions of where to deploy that extremely valuable resource, manpower. And so as we look at all these options and we try to be smart about where we deploy that manpower and we use that technology to amplify that manpower, we are experiencing success in that manner. And I point to the reduction in the crime rate. And I also point to our success in seizing illegal guns that's been a priority set by Mayor Tisdall and the City Council. We have focused on that illegal gun trafficking, and just this last weekend seized four more illegal guns. And so that contributes once again to the quality of life, and that is the trajectory the department's on.
A lot of the police departments are looking at cameras, either cameras in the community, cameras on dashboards of police cars, or cameras on police officers. Where does the city of Evanston fit, and what kind of budget implications does video have for us?
Well, let me talk about where we're at right now and the budget implications, which are significant. Right now, we have a number of fixed position cameras throughout the city. In addition to those fixed position cameras, we have dashboard cameras, which the city has had for quite some time. That's getting near the end of its useful life, and we are in discussion with Northwestern University to see which path they're going down on fixed position cameras and body cameras and in-car cameras. We hopefully that use of their technology and their R&D research will allow us a pathway that we don't have to invest considerable resources in ferreting out those best options. Now, when we talk about body cameras, that would be a new option for the City of Evanston Police Department. Body cameras are going to be a significant issue. Let me talk about the money part first, because this is a budget hearing. It's going to be startup costs to equip the officers of the Evanston Police Department with a functioning body camera system will be about $600,000 in the first year. Now, part of that will be personnel costs to manage the system. We estimate it will be two full-time people just to manage the data, because the example I like to use of the volume of data we're talking about, the data we collect now via camera between the dash cams, the cell block cameras, the fixed cameras throughout the city is about the size of a 12-ounce Coke can. We're going to an oil tanker when we go to body cameras. We are going to have to manage that volume of data. And so the storage and retrieval of the data is the expense. The volume of Freedom of Information Act requests that will come with a body camera system will be astronomical. We already field a huge number of Freedom of Information Act requests. It's extremely time consuming, and even with the redaction software programs that are available for body cameras, this will be a labor intensive endeavor that will only continue to grow. Also, let me talk for just a minute about the privacy issues that are connected to this debate that I think in some ways will supersede the money aspects. When we talk about redactions, yes, the software exists where we can redact people's faces. But I think that you all know, reflect on going to your great aunt's house for Thanksgiving dinner. There is a unique set of curtains in that home. You know that's your aunt's house, even if everybody's face is blurry. One of the recent examples I've used is if you go to Three Crown Center in their meeting room, if you look down at that carpet, you know you're in Three Crown Center. You're not going to see that carpet anyplace else. The redaction program will not handle that. We can't. And so we are going to have to balance what we think the cameras will give us, in theory, control of the police, versus the privacy issues that will come in the continuing expense. And so I kind of look forward to that debate as the camera option comes to fruition, as we get the technical issues ironed out. Also, I might add that there are issues in the current Illinois law that deal with the cameras that are not crystal clear. What is a reasonable expectation of privacy once you have summoned the police department to your home? These issues have not been ironed out yet, and I believe that we have gotten some sage advice from Corporation Counsel to let others spend their legal dollars to really find out what the legislature meant when it used those words.
So what do you think the timing is? How much of this will we do in 2017? How much of this will be in future years?
I think the R&D will be completed in 2017. We'll know which cameras we want, and then we'll make a decision of what in which order they go. So I think the R&D will be wrapped up in 2017. The money out the door will start in 2018.
We have a question, Chief, from a Twitter user. How do you ensure that the revenue EPD is expected to generate does not result in excessive ticket writing by officers? Did it come in just that way, or did you clean that up? Well, that's a very well-written question. So how do you force, when budget times are bad, do you force police officers to write more tickets, or how does that all work?
Well, let me say this. The state of Illinois, one of Governor Quinn's last official acts was to sign off on legislation that forbade the use of ticket quotas to evaluate officers. So I don't think we're in any danger of excessive ticket writing. Okay. I think we're pretty safe there. And once again, just from a personal moral perspective, as soon as you begin to mix a revenue generation with police service, bad things happen. I think if you see the frustration that manifested itself in Ferguson, Missouri, it wasn't, yes, the police-involved shooting was the spark that ignited it, but if you look at how the local municipal court system was run as almost a random arm tax collector, that's what generated the angst and anger that we saw on TV. So we keep revenue generation at arm's length. That is not our mission. That's not our function.
We have another question. This one's a text message to our 311 center. What emphasis has been placed on encouraging police officers to issue administrative citations for violations? In other words, having administrative hearing have jurisdiction of the violation, which would be a means of decreasing police overtime and having the city maximize on collecting revenue from those citations.
Yes, we have emphasized the use of administrative ticketing. We use that extensively for cell phones and seat belts. And there is an advantage, many advantages, not only to the officer, but to the motorist. If we bring you here to the city of Evanston to adjudicate this matter, we're talking fines in the range of $50. If you go out to Skokie Court, the fees are at a minimum $125. And so this is, we're getting enforcement, we're getting compliance at a lower cost to the motorist, and it also lowers our overhead costs because the officers do not have to appear for the administrative hearing, and also there's no fees subtracted. All that money goes directly to the city of Evanston rather than cycling through the court system.
And Chief, the net of that is that the revenue to the city of Evanston is about the same as the revenue if they'd gone to Skokie, but the cost to the resident is much higher. So we would get approximately one-third of a ticket that went to Skokie, whereas we get all of the ticket, and we do have our own administrative costs for it. But I think the key is that there is a much lower financial impact to the resident, to the offender.
Absolutely.
And also in time, it is a much quicker process as far as time. We have less overtime, but that individual that's going to court, it's a much quicker process.
Another question, this one from Twitter, talking about the implementation of the camera technology you talked about. This person's asking, are we seeking grants and partnerships to fund full and fast implementation? I think probably the best answer to that, Chief, is what we're doing with Northwestern University, and I'll take a little bit of this, that in working with the Northwestern University Police Department, they have really volunteered and stepped up to be great partners in this. So I think that while grants opportunities, we have applied for grants through the Cook County Department of Homeland Security, and I think we'll continue to do that. Really, the best partnership will be with Northwestern University. They're in the process of buying body cameras. They already have dash cameras. And Chief, what's the approximate number of fixed cameras that they monitor? It's in the thousands.
Almost 1,500.
1,500. So Northwestern is already managing 1,500 cameras, and we manage approximately how many fixed cameras?
About 25 camera locations.
So we're looking at working with Northwestern, leveraging their technology with the 1,500 cameras they have to use that same similar technology to manage our cameras, and then to work with them on body cameras and dash cams. So I think that is the partnership that will hopefully save us a lot of money. And then a final question for the Chief, and then we're going to move on to the fire department, about overtime. What leads to police overtime? Approximately how much do we spend on police overtime, and what can we do to manage that?
We manage the overtime closely. That is a key function of our frontline supervisors. The question regarding what crimes drive overtime, the crime that drives overtime is a major event like a homicide. That is a huge overtime generator. I think that in the staffing of any 24/7 operation, the absence of personnel drives the consumption and the use of overtime to maintain staffing. We have many officers who have experienced FMLA leaves of absence for the birth of children, and so those officers need to be replaced while they're out on that time. And so those internal issues are all overtime generators, much more so than the crimes. It's only those serious criminal events like homicide or criminal sexual assault where overtime would be directly tied to a crime. It is much more a staffing issue to maintain the staffing level needed to maintain the safety in the city.
And as a city, we manage overtime very closely. It is reviewed by my office, Marty staff, on a quarterly basis, and is questioned. Anything outside of any kind of normal parameter is questioned, and each department director is responsible for responding to that. So we monitor citywide overtime very closely. Let's move on, Chief, to another hat you're wearing for the next couple of months, and that is the supervision of the fire department, another large 24-hour-a-day department. I think maybe the same question we started with police, just as far as breadth and depth of what it takes to operate fire services in the city of Evanston.
Well, I think that the fire service is another complex endeavor in a complex city. I think that the fire department has done an excellent job in outreach to the community with the start of their Fire Explorer program, their Citizens Fire Academy. They run monthly courses in CPR and first aid. One of the things that I think is unique that in a joint program between police and fire, we run a college credit class at ETHS for juniors and seniors that are interested in careers in fire service or police service. And to all those parents watching at home, it is critical that you pick up those college eligible credits while they're in high school. It lets them pick as a second semester freshman when they go to school, which will help you get them out in 4 years. I know this from experience, so this is please encourage them to get those credits when they're in high school. The fire department also does a number of community-wide events. They'll be out at Bike the Ridge along with the police department this weekend, and they make many appearances at the condo associations for fire education. So it is a complex service. One of the things I'd like to mention on the slide that I shows their That was a good slide too, but back to fire. That the department's commitment to obtaining pediatric advanced life support certifications for the paramedics is a sign of their commitment to the well-being of the children of the city of Evanston. They are very focused on providing that service to the citizens.
So 110 full-time positions, that's probably what, 98%, 99% sworn firefighters, paramedics in five fire stations, staffed 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So $22.6 million. The fire department this year will likely surpass 10,000 calls for service for the first time in its 120-odd year history. So lots of things happening with the fire department. Alex, I don't see any specific questions for the fire department. So I'll say, Chief, is there anything else you'd like to add?
I would just like to put a plug in for Division Chief Hull's efforts in upgrading the city's emergency preparedness. Deputy Chief Hull and I are in a class this week with the Department of Homeland Security and Emergency Management for Cook County, and the fire department is the lead agency for the city in our emergency preparedness, and I want to express my appreciation to Division Chief Hull for his work in that area.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
We're going to move on now to our Health and Human Services Department. But let me again remind folks that we're here this evening talking about budget issues facing the community for 2017. You can participate by coming down to the Ray Martin Civic Center or send your notices to us through email or Twitter or Facebook. There was one other question for the chief, which I think if we have time at the end, since we're an hour and 15 minutes in, we'll get back to later. But Evonda Thomas-Smith is our Director of Health and Human Services. Good evening, Evonda.
Good evening.
Happy to have you. Why don't you tell us a little bit about the 21.1 FTEs that work in the Health Department, the different things that they do?
Sure. So thank you for allowing me to speak on behalf of the department. So we have two divisions, and that's Environmental Health and a Human Services division. And basically what that means is we have about 21 full-time employees that are skilled in providing environmental health programs that encompass inspections, whether they're food inspections, food establishment inspections, and food events. And so that is inclusive of not only our robust restaurants, but all of our activities that serve food to our public. That's farmers markets and baking events at faith-based communities, our soup kitchens, et cetera. And we also have inspectors that specialize in property maintenance. And the combination of the seven of those inspectors really engage with the community on a deep level, whether it's education, whether it's monitoring and surveillance, and also enforcement. Some of that enforcement comes through properties that are not maintained, or whether they're external properties that are not maintained, whether it's a weed or harborage. And I'm happy to say that this team also was instrumental in working alongside with our business community and residents to really arrest or address the rodent population and pest management. And with the implementation of 311 and the education and just the engagement and stellar intellect of our community has been skilled in reaching out to 311 to file appropriate complaints. And our staff have been walking the alleys with the residents to identify rodent harborage, to identify areas where rodents lurk about. And so in response to this education and the surveillance effort, we've seen a decrease in our rodent population. It has not been eradicated, but there has been a significant decrease and a significant interest in the community really becoming more compliant about addressing that problem. And then we have our Human Services division, where we have licensed social workers, human service specialists that really deal with families that are having challenges with stable housing. We have a general assistance program, as you know, we've integrated into Health and Human Services that really allows residents who are entitled to receive some financial support, as well as support for employment opportunities, workforce development, coaching for jobs, mentoring. And I'm happy to say that with the integration of the township services in the department, we have seen a significant decrease in our participants. And so that means that participants are becoming employed and that participants are being re-engaged and unified with families. And so that may mean that they move in and out of the community, and that we're seeing more our participants getting the services that they're entitled to receive.
So there was a lot of discussion in the community when the township question was debated, and ultimately with the township's dissolution.
Yes.
So in your sense, are we saving money? Is it costing us more money? Are we providing the same service? Are we providing better service? So how has that all worked out, do you think?
Sure. Initially, I think there was a significant decrease or savings. And that savings is it's complex. It was ideal of timing that the Affordable Care Act was available for participants to receive comprehensive medical care at the cost that we should have been paying on their behalf. The timing allowed for us to leverage the partnership, a deeper partnership with Erie Family Health Center, to assure that our participants were engaged in services, whether or not they were connected to a primary care care physician. And so with that connection of and that access to care, we saw a significant decrease in our medical cost. And the wonderful thing about not only the savings, the monetary savings, the new level of care that participants are receiving because they know their primary care provider, they know their physician, they're getting the much needed care that they needed outside of an emergency room.
That's great. Let me turn to Marty Lyons. So Evonda has talked a lot about the services that we're doing. How are we paying for this? How is that money collected? Is it part of the general fund? Is it something separate? Is it a separate line on the property tax? How are we funding those traditional township services now?
Thank you, Ollie. When we dissolved the township immediately prior to that, it had a line on every resident's or in every property owner's tax bill. And in working with the county, we were able to reestablish that under a, you'll see it on a tax bill that says GA assistance, general assistance on the tax bill. So that transparency we've been able to maintain. And the last levy that we had with the township was a little over $1.2 million. And this last year we were at $1 million even for the levy. And thanks to Ms. Thomas-Smith's efforts and her team, we had saved dollars underneath that. So, and you I know we're not talking about next year's budgets and we're trying to avoid that, but one of our goals is now to reinvest that. We have less recipients because of our effectiveness. We're going to try and help those less recipients with higher dollars if that's possible. So that's, I think, very important. But a key thing through these last 3 years is to show the expenditures and the bill on someone's tax bill going down and the services going up, so that we can show that the putting of the two jurisdictions together was indeed cost effective and did not cost any recipients the loss of their benefits.
That's correct.
And this is all covered outside of the general fund, correct?
Oh, sorry, yes. So the general assistance fund is one of those separate funds. It does not take funds away from police or fire operations and vice versa. If we have issues where we had higher operating costs, those would not impact the general assistance fund.
One last question, Yvonne. Looking at the slide there, you know, it shows that budgeted expenses for the departments are $3.6 million, but revenues, $1.2 million. Can you talk a little bit about, that's quite a large percentage of your budget coming from other sources. So could you maybe talk a little bit about the fundraising that you do for special projects, the grants that you receive from various places that help kind of extend those general dollars?
Sure. How we extend the general dollars, I just want to stop and thank the community stakeholders and collaborative partners that we have. We do have some creative partnerships that really allow us to do some really unique things. And in terms of fundraising, because of the relationships and the longstanding commitment that our community stakeholders have to the well-being of the citizens of Evanston, it makes it really easy to reach out and join efforts, whether it's financial efforts, educational efforts, and share resources to make sure that we address not only those that are living on the fringes of life or in crisis, but those who are entitled to optimal wellness. So some of those fundraising efforts are a one-time kind of event, and some of them are longstanding. Both of our wonderful hospitals in this jurisdiction have been longstanding partners of many of our initiatives that really holistically address families and residents that live here, work here, and play here.
That's great. I don't know that we have any specific questions for Health and Human Services, so
thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Happy to have you. And as we have our next director, Lawrence Hemingway, come up, again, we're here tonight talking about the 2017 budget. There is still time to come down to the Lorraine Morton Civic Center and ask your questions. You can reach us by calling 311. You can reach out to us on Twitter, by email, by calling, by Facebook, by texting us. We're here to answer your questions about the proposed 2017 budget, which we'll be presenting to the City Council on October 7th. But next, joining me here this evening is Lawrence Hemingway. Lawrence is, we're almost to the point of not calling you the new Director of Parks, Recreation, and Community Services, but Lawrence came to us at the beginning of the year. from Wayne County, where he was the director of their Parks Department there. So Lawrence, welcome. Welcome to Evanston. Welcome here tonight to talk about your budget. Your department has so many things that it offers. I'll just kind of let you talk a little bit about some of the things. You have 77 employees, $11.8 million budget. Talk a little bit about what your department does.
All right. Thanks, Wally, and I appreciate the opportunity for being here and serving the citizens of Evanston. As you mentioned, our department is made up of over 77 FTEs. Part of that is we have approximately 53 full-time employees, and then the remaining employees are part-time employees. And so we have about approximately 65 part-time employees, and then we have hundreds of seasonals, and to help us through our seasonal operations. With that, we are divided and operate in two divisions. One division, the Recreation Division, and then our Community Services Division. Under the Recreation Division, we operate our recreation centers, the Robert Crown, the Chandler Newburger, the Fleetwood Jourdain. That includes the lakefront and the beach operations, all of our athletics, as well as our boat launch. Sits under our Recreation Division. The other division is our Community Services Division. Under the Community Services, we operate our youth and young adults. We operate the Levy Senior Center, the Noyes Cultural Arts and Gibbs Morrison Cultural Arts Center. We operate our community arts, which includes our festivals and our movies in the park, as well as our Fleetwood Jourdain Theater. We kind of touch all of Evanstonians. We have programs that include preschool, and of course, we serve our most senior citizens that are in our community.
We heard Lawrence a little bit earlier this evening from Police Chief Eddington talking about violence issues and ways to combat violence in the community, and certainly law enforcement is only a piece of that. Your department, through your Youth and Young Adult Division, does a lot of that. Maybe talk a little bit about that division, what it entails, and the work that they do.
Absolutely, thanks. Our Youth and Young Adult Division is a staff of 8 individuals, and their main mission is to be on the proactive side to engage Evanstonians in efforts to help people and provide resources in terms of helping young people, especially our teenagers, ages 14 and 18, to make positive decisions before they end up being involved with the law department. But it's not just that. We also focus on a huge workforce development side with the youth and young adults for our more 18 to 30-year-old group, where we try to marry individuals with job opportunities and workforce opportunities that will help them lead to gainful employment. We meet individual families and individuals exactly where they are. So if there are homeless issues, if there are violence issues, that youth and young adult team steps up and they meet the individual where they're needed, and then we try to marry them to the various services that our community partners provide here in Evanston.
Also looking at the slide with expenses of $11.8 million, very healthy revenues, $5.7 million projecting a little over $6 million. I think one of the challenges we have is that balance between providing services free of charge and then providing services for a fee. We obviously collect funds at the lakefront for admission for Memorial Day to Labor Day, fees for classes. As a Parks and Rec professional, what's the philosophy? Is there a philosophy, and how best do we balance that? Because in difficult economic times, isn't it tempting just to simply say, well, let's raise Parks and Rec fees X percentage, and that'll help cover the budget? Previous Parks and Rec directors I've worked with here and elsewhere have said, well, wait. There are larger issues at stake here. Yeah. What's your take on the fee for service issue in a Parks Department?
Well, you're right. There are different philosophies throughout the profession, but one thing that the public needs to understand, the services, yes, we're a general fund funded entity, but the general fund, as you can see, does not cover all our costs and our expenses. And with that being said, there has to be a medium in which or a happy middle ground in which the municipality needs to be able to recoup some cost. And so my philosophy is, as long as the community, the fees are not, they're equitable, and there are opportunities for scholarships and things that are provided for the, some, for those individuals who could not necessarily afford those fees, then I think, it is appropriate to charge those kinds of fees in our profession.
Looks like we have a question from a member of the audience talking about the Harley Clark Mansion. As many people are aware, the council, city council, has grappled with the issue of the Harley Clark Mansion for the last few years. Recently, the council has indicated $250,000 to cover some initial maintenance. The question asks how much more is projected for the building, and I think the answer is we're really not sure.
Right.
We've done some initial projections,
yes.
Which we're are doing, I think, to make the building available for Parks and Rec programs next summer.
Yes.
So that will be in the process, and we will spend that first $250,000, I think, to the highest and best use for the property. But then it talks about operation funds. Why don't you talk a little bit about what your initial plans are for next summer as far as operating, and will that require additional dollars, or will we just use some redirect some additional existing dollars?
Yeah, absolutely. Next summer, the plan will be working with first, you know, just to add to your comments, Wally, working with our colleagues that, you know, head up our capital. We are already hard at work at looking at what those additional costs may or may not be based on what the council has allocated. But our initial operating plan will be to take our existing camp programs that currently operate in the two fog houses that are part of the property at the mansion. We're going to move those programs from outside or from the fog houses and into the mansion once it the renovations have been made. So it won't take any additional staff immediately to open up the facility and run our programs from there.
I don't see any other questions from the public, so thank you very much, Lawrence. We're so happy you're part of the team. Lots of things going on in Parks and Rec.
All right. Thanks a lot. I'm glad to be here.
We're now going to move on to our Public Works Agency, Dave Stonebeck, the Public Works Agency Director. Just to remind everyone, we're here at the Morton Civic Center talking about the 2017 City of Evanston budget, getting some community feedback. If folks haven't submitted questions, there's still time. Can reach us through Facebook, through Twitter, by calling 311, by emailing us, by texting us. We're anxious to get your questions as well as to hear from folks here in the audience. I have with me now Dave Stonebeck, the director of our Public Works Agency. Dave, a big operation recently reconstituted over the last year or so. Maybe just talk in general terms about how many folks it takes to run the operations and just an overview of what the Public Works Agency does.
Well, there's a total of 155 employees in the Public Works Agency. There's 55 in Environmental Services, and those employees provide services for collection of the recycling throughout the city and street sweeping, as well as some cleanup in the downtown area. There's a forestry division that maintains the 32,000 trees that are throughout Evanston. And then there is a greenways division that maintains all the green space that are on city-owned properties, whether it's in front of the community centers, the civic center, or in the ball fields. They're responsible for all the athletic field striping and mowing, things like that. There's an infrastructure maintenance bureau that's responsible for maintaining the infrastructure of the city. There's 45 employees in that. They maintain the water distribution system, the sewer conveyance system. They maintain all the streets, the alleys, and then all the traffic signals, street lights, traffic signs, a very big project there. There's the Water Production Bureau, which is responsible for operations and water treatment plant. There's approximately 30 employees working over there that work in the pumping and filtering of the water and getting it into the distribution system. And then finally, there's the Engineering Capital Planning Division with 15 employees in it that do all the planning for the capital improvements programs and oversee construction projects, work with consultants on larger projects to make sure that the designs are correct and keep the building going in Evanston.
That's great. I think if we have some questions, I think why don't we just get right to them. One from the audience dealing with water. The City Council, as people might be aware, heard a presentation on Monday evening from you, Dave, regarding water and sewer rates. The question is, why not a reduction to taxpayers if we're lowering the sewer rate? Why should those taxpayers get that money back rather than see the water rate goes up? So I think the question is, why is the sewer rate going down? Why is the water rate going up? I think ultimately the decision of how that money is spent is up to the City Council, but maybe you could just talk a little bit about the changes in both the sewer and the water rate.
The sewer rate is almost 90% debt service. And that's because between 1991 and 2008, the city spent $210 million putting in a long-range sewer improvement program. That debt service, because of some of the initial loans and debt, is over 20 years old. That debt service is retiring, which then allows us to reduce the sewer rate. Staff is recommending that the water rate increase be implemented, because even though we sell wholesale water to other municipalities, they help to pay for the infrastructure improvements at the water treatment plant. But those wholesale customers do not pay for the distribution system within Evanston, the 157 miles of water main in Evanston. They don't pay for the two water storage tanks in Evanston. They don't pay for the 14,400 water meters that are scattered throughout Evanston as well, and 14,400 water services that need to be maintained and replaced. So the biggest reason is that the city's trying to achieve a goal of replacing 1% of our water mains a year, which is 1.5 miles. It costs a neighborhood of $3.5 to $4 million to do that work. And if we continue to do that on an annual basis, it'd be more appropriate to be able to pay for that expense from generated revenue rather than having to borrow that money. So if you borrow the money, you have to pay interest on top of it as well.
There's another question. We're going to talk about the capital program a little later on, but this is from Twitter regarding roof repair at the James Park Fieldhouse. Will that space be open for public use soon?
I believe that it will, yes. This project was just recently awarded, and it does do more than just a roof replacement. There are some other structural improvements being completed on the building itself and the replacement of the roof.
And I think our Parks and Rec director is still here, who's not near a camera or a microphone, but anything you want to add that we can repeat on the use of that facility?
Well, once the capital repairs are completed, now that we're in the process of getting them completed, we will be looking now to see alternative ways that we could program that facility.
So once the repairs are completed, we will continue to program it at a greater degree.
That's correct.
Very good. I don't see any other public works questions. We'll come back. We may ask you to come up and talk a little bit more about capital projects, but a big operation with public works, lots going on. So Dave, thank you for coming by tonight. So that takes us through our operating departments. I think this next slide is really more of a summary than anything else, and that is to kind of just give you a sense of the proportions. If you look, the purple or purple on one screen, blue on another screen, police and fire over half of 53.7% of our operating budget. So when you look at what our operations costs are, pretty significant with police and fire, and then you can see proportionally a public works agency, Parks and Rec, have big pieces to that. Marty, before we go on, I think one thing that we haven't really touched on and probably need to touch on is issues of debt and issues of pensions. That, you know, while we talk about all these day-to-day operations, one of the things that kind of hangs over us is debt service for projects already done, and then our obligations not only to pay into the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund, but also obligations for police and fire pensions. So maybe we could talk a little bit about some of those particulars.
Certainly. We don't have a slide specifically to encapsulate them all. We do have the pension funds. Let me get to that one. That's at the end.
Page 44.
Water, sewer. So first, we'll talk about the pension funds. As many of you, and I think I referenced this early on, the city is a part of a defined benefit plan for all of our civilian staff that's managed at the state level, but not by the state. The Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund is an independent agent from the state, and that is one of the reasons why they're 90% funded as opposed to all of the state-run plans, which are closer to 30 to 40%. Funded. So that is not a burden on the city as far as paying back debt. We can't say the same thing for our police and fire pension funds. Those are locally run by local boards per state statute. And right now they are at 50% funding with police being a little bit better funded than fire. When I arrived at the city, we had just gone through a blue ribbon panel and had changed the way we were going to approach funding, and have we reduced a lot of our assumptions. That means that we started to be more conservative, saying that we wouldn't make a bunch of money in the future, and that wouldn't pay for all of these pensions. We had to be a little bit more conservative, and that had the effect of taking those funds both down to 40 and just below 40% funded. So through time, in the last 6 years, we have got them back up to nearly 50% funding while still having more conservative assumptions than most pension funds. And that's important because that's transparency. If you want to say that you're going to earn 8% investment income to pay for your pensions, but you can't, then that's just passing the buck down to future taxpayers who will end up paying those pensions down the road. Our outstanding liability when we're at 50% funded is approaching $200 million, and that's how much do we owe all the way through the year 2040. And that's important to have that year out there. That means we have 24 years in which to make up the outstanding liability. Another way to look at that is, though, we also have a lot of money in the bank, about $180 million in the bank for these same pensions. So we are not in any danger of having any of our pensioners not have their pensions. Some actuaries would look at this and say they could count how many years of pensions do you have if you didn't even make a single payment. Well, we'd have 10 years if we didn't even make another payment. But we're making payments that are actually growing our funding every year. So there is no danger for that to happen with our current plan, but it is a burden when you go back to the slide that the city manager just showed. In years past, we would have shown police and fire at closer to 47-48%, but they didn't have to have their pension costs shown in the general fund. And new rules have said, for transparency purposes, put all the pension costs where the people are. So that has increased their costs. Police, for instance, went from $28 million to $37 million as an annual budget because of pension costs. But at $16.7 million, that is our largest portion of our tax levy, which is just over $40 million, goes to police and fire pensions. A little, approximately $11 million goes for debt, and $11 million goes for our general operating current salaries for police and fire. So it is a very large issue, but it is one we continue to improve upon slowly. So that's okay news. As far as our regular debt, that's called general obligation debt, 10 years ago we had $199 million of general obligation debt. This year we have under $150 million of general obligation debt. And that's important because, number one, we do need to still use general obligation debt to pay for facilities such as the Crown Center. So by reducing our debt over the last 7 to 8 years, we have the potential to grow it back a little bit without overly burdening the taxpayer. And that is something that if you care to, you can look at online. We have both our Moody's and Fitch ratings of our bonds and how we manage our debt are both on the city's website at cityofevanston.org under the transparency portion of our webpage. They say wonderful things about management. They say that our pension situation is difficult, but we are trying, and we are a AA2 rated municipality, which is for us produced a 2.5% bond rate, meaning that we borrowed $14 million at 2.5%. That's as low as I've ever done in 30 years in the business. And that speaks well for this community, because it's the community that the bond buyers are looking at. They're saying this is a community we'd like to invest in. Anything else you'd like me to hit?
I think that does it. Another question from the audience: how do Evanston police and fire expenditures compare to similar communities? You know, certainly in my experience, and Marty, correct me if you feel something different, you know, a rule of thumb is that in a general fund, police and fire is usually just a little over 50% of the budget, and I think we're at 52 or 53%. So I would say that our expenditures are fairly average in that regard. So I think we get a lot for the revenues or from the expenditures that we make with the police and fire department. So we're it's 8:50 this evening. We're still have a few other points we want to cover. Johanna Leonard, our manager of economic development, is here, and I will ask just Johanna to come up and chat for just a few minutes with us, because when you look at we've talked a lot about on the expenditure side, we've talked about revenues, and we will talk a little bit more about revenues, but really the economic activity in the community is a big part of increasing revenues, and Johanna is our economic development manager. You and your team really work hard to make sure that that economic activity continues to grow, which really rises the whole boat of the city government. So what do you see as we're going into 17 and beyond, some of the issues that we're facing both on the good side and on the bad side when it comes to economic development?
So great to be here. The good side, people want to be in Evanston. This is an attractive place. We've been able to cultivate the urban yet suburban feel for the business districts, for our residential areas, and that's a very attractive piece. And we like to say we don't have a huge shopping mall or a huge auto row, but we have the quality of life that is so attractive and so essential to enjoying that third place outside your home or work, dining, shopping, entertainment. We have those things here, and it's very scalable for people to enjoy. As we look to 2017, the things to enjoy for that and to get excited for would be the experience businesses that we're really trying to build more of, such as going to Little Beans and hanging out with your kid while they go in the Play Cafe and enjoy a cup of coffee, or going to Bottle and Bottega and painting a picture. Those are the kind of things that people are looking to have, and what can we do as we move forward into 2017 to make sure more businesses are offering those types of things. I think challenges, one thing is we have workforce opportunities. We can't always get employers in those businesses to be able to access available workers for those businesses. We're hearing we have a lot of restaurants, it's great, but they can't always get a lot of workers to come and be employed there. So that's a big challenge and an opportunity, because we know that there's many people in Evanston that want jobs. So connecting the people that want jobs to those that want to offer jobs will be a big piece of 2017.
So most communities look at retail sales as being a generator, hotels, auto dealers. Where do we stack up in those sort of three areas of retail sales, hotels, and auto dealers? Has there been any movement, any changes during 2016 that will hopefully carry us into 2017 and beyond?
Well, the latter two, we have one car dealer, and that car dealer has just expanded significantly in Evanston. So they've added another dealership, which is pretty rare for a landlocked community like Evanston. So that's an area of growth for us, hopefully, that will continue to occur. We just had a number that they added close to 50 new jobs with this expansion. So they backfilled with existing employees and added new ones throughout the dealership. So that's a good thing. In terms of hotels, we just added a hotel. We may have another one. What we've learned through the hotel business is that often hotels, one doesn't necessarily, an addition of one doesn't necessarily mean others won't come. the hotels like to cluster because they like to be part of a offering and competitive offering of hotels. In terms of retail, we've grown steadily over the years in small increments, not with great significance, but enough that we're still comfortable and feel good about the offering that we have.
And is it unusual for a community the size of Evanston to have the neighborhood business districts? I mean, we've got, how many neighborhood business districts would you say we have?
Depending on how you constitute them, it's about 10. So that is really probably rare for a suburb of Evanston size, and just a suburb in general. Most suburbs just have the downtown, they have one train station. We have three metro rail stations and several CTA stations and PACE bus and CTA service. And those neighborhood business districts have grown because we have compact housing that has drawn the commercial to those areas. We have larger areas to the west that are more of the, quote, big box retailers that people can generally drive to, but certainly we're a very walkable community. So there's just a wide range of things that you can get and access in Evanston.
Mr. Lyons, so there's an economic development fund. What is that? Where does the money go? How is it used? And are there opportunities for that fund you see in the future to assist in a broader sense with the city's financial needs?
Thank you. Yes, we have an economic development fund. In terms of the presentation tonight, it would be a special revenue fund. And it is, we use hotel tax revenues and amusement tax revenues as a funding source. And in there, we have Ms. Leonard's team. They are paid for out of there, as well as a few other expenses that all are economic development-related expenses. Then we also have somewhere between $800,000 and $900,000 in economic development activities, of which I'll let Johanna go into some of the details, but between great merchant grants, supporting the downtown as far as additional cleanup, additional landscaping support and marketing for the downtown, and then also for all of our business districts. So those funds are all currently used to continue to make sure our sales tax stays stable or grows, and to make sure all of our business communities are supported. And that's a great source of revenue because the amusement and hotel tax, for the most part, is non-Evanstonians supporting Evanston. So, and again, as you noted, Johanna, having not a lot of towns had two hotels renovate and a new hotel come in within a space of 5 years. So that, points well towards the attractiveness of Evanston as a destination, whether temporarily or permanently. For the future, that fund has reserves that are higher than the city's current operating fund reserves. There is no specific state statute that would limit the city from using hotel or amusement taxes for other purposes. So in a way, those funds are also available not only for development, but also for contingency purposes. If the state of Illinois decided to reduce some of our revenues, there's the potential that this home rule revenue of hotel tax could be used to help us continue our operations without changes in the level of services while we figure out long-term solutions. So this source of funding is important because it's not a burden on our current residents. It is flexible. We can use it to continue to build the city, or in downtimes, we can use it to support current services to the city. And we'll be looking at those options for the 2017 budget.
Well, Mrs. Leonard, thank you for joining us tonight. I think a lot of interesting things happening in economic development, a lot of key indicators that we'll need to keep watching as we move forward in 2017. So thanks for joining us. We've talked about all the departments that report to the city manager. There's one department, however, that does not, but an integral part of our operations, and that is the Evanston Public Library. Our library director, Karen Danzig-Lyons, is here, and we'll talk a little bit about what's going on with the library, some funding issues there. There's a question, which I'll answer while Ms. Lyons is settling in, and that is, what is the projected property tax increase? A question from the audience. We have not raised the property tax for general operations in the 7 years I've been city manager, and probably a few years before that. It actually has decreased over time. So as far as any adjustments that we've seen in the property tax, they have been either for props, oh my goodness. the adjustments to the property tax have either been to pay our pension obligations or to pay debt. And I think at this point, we don't have an answer to that question. We are, I think, feel pretty comfortable with our payment of debt. I think what we're still looking at is what our pension obligations are. Those change annually based on actuarial reports that are done for the police and fire pension. We, I think, have a fairly good sense of where we are with the Illinois Municipal Retirement Fund, but the adjustments would come because of police and fire pension issues. So we are in the process of wrapping that up, and while I don't know that we can even comment on it at this point, our goal is zero, and that's what we're going to hopefully shoot for over the next couple of weeks. So thank you for that question. Karen Daszak-Lyons, good evening. Welcome. You had your own budget hearing with your board earlier this evening. Hopefully that went well. Many people in the community who have followed issues of the municipal government know that we've made some changes in the library's governance and its funding over the last few years. Why don't you just briefly touch on the current state of that? How does the library get its money? How is it governed perhaps differently than how it was in previous years in Evanston?
Good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure to be with you tonight. Unlike other departments, there is an Illinois and Illinois Public Library Act, and so we are governed first by Illinois library law, and recently, over the last few years, working together with the city manager's office, we refined the way we work, and we are now complying with Illinois library law. We have a memorandum of understanding, so we are a municipal library. We serve all of our residents, but technically we're not a city department. However, we do not, under Illinois library law, have the ability to levy our own taxes, and so on our behalf, the city of Evanston levies our taxes, and as most public libraries in Illinois, the majority of our funding is through the local property tax.
Looking at your budget, revenue and expenses pretty much cover that, and how much would you say of on the revenue side is your property tax levy versus other fees and charges that you receive?
Oh, it's by far the vast majority. We do our best to write grants and to find other non-property tax sources, but virtually all of our budget is property tax.
The library has been doing a lot of capital projects, both investing in the main library, investing in the Central Street branch. Capital projects looking forward in 2017 for the library?
Well, have you been talking about Robert Crown?
Oh, we have in bits and pieces, yes, but go ahead and talk about it some more if
you'd
like.
Well, I am so excited that we'll be adding a new star in our constellation of services. The Robert Crown Library will be our newest branch. It will be the only branch that's constructed to be a branch, and it's 5,000 square feet plus a reading garden. And co-locating with our wonderful partners in Parks and Recreation, we can deepen our engagement, helping grow minds and grow young bodies, supporting the preschool, supporting the homework needs. So if the rink is really cold and you've got a fidgety five-year-old, bring them to the library. If you've got homework to do, come early, take your skates off and come into the library and work with us. We'll also do quite a bit of computer training. We'll have free access, as we do at all of our locations, to our computers, and we'll train you how to use your devices. We'll teach you how to use computers, and I'm particularly proud of something that we are piloting this year, and I hope to expand next year, but this was through grant funding this year. We know from Evanston 150 that one of the goals was to bring broadband access to every one of our residents, and if I apply Pew National Research findings to Evanston, it suggests that about 14% of our households don't have broadband access at home. And so it's wonderful to begin your research or begin your job search at the library, but you need to continue it at home. And so right now, I have 30 of these devices, and with an Evanston Public Library card in good standing, you can check out one of these devices, and we pay the data charges. We buy the devices, but it will activate up to 5 computers or smartphones in your home, so you can continue your research and your job search at home. We just ask that you bring it back and let someone else check it out. Right now, so we have 30 of these. Right now, I just checked the whole queue, and there are 60 people waiting for this.
60
people. And so we're in the pilot phase, and right now during the pilot phase, I wanted to make sure that this works and that it makes sense and it's easy to work. I'm hoping in our budget next year to find some grant funding to expand it. I'm also hoping to have some of these that our students can check out at the high school. Most of my colleagues in other public libraries, you have to be 18 or older. Here in Evanston, with the library card, you can be 16, because I think our teens are responsible and they need to be able to do their homework at home. And so I want a group of these to be at the high school that the students can check out. So I'm really proud about that. I am proud that we're offering our second storytelling festival. So come and join us the first week in October, and you don't have to be little, but you can be. We have stories for adults, we have stories for the whole family, it's free. One of the things that distinguishes our storytelling festival is that, first of all, it's free of charge, but along with bringing nationally and internationally recognized storytellers to share their stories, we highlight District 65 students, we highlight ETHS, we have a poetry slam, and we have Northwestern students. And we also have workshops, so if you've always wanted to tell your story and you're not quite sure you can come to a workshop and learn tips, and then we're going to have an open mic so you can share your stories with us. I won't unpack this, but this is something I'm very, very proud of again this year. ABC Boosters, I think, could serve as a national model for programs. We work with Parks and Rec, again, our good partners, and the Youth Job Center. We hire teens, and we'll hire 14 and 15-year-olds. And so for many of our kids, it's their first job, and they learn job skills. And then we have District 65 teachers that teach the teens how to teach the little ones their ABCs. One of our important elements in our vision statement is every child ready to learn when they enter kindergarten. And working with District 65, they help us find rising kindergartners, 5-year-olds, that don't know their whole alphabet necessarily, and they don't know their colors and their numbers. And so for 5 weeks, a teen, a new important teen in the little one's life, sits with them individually and reads and plays. And we have proven results. Again, this summer, we had one little boy who started the 5 weeks, and he didn't know any of his alphabet. And by the end, he knew the upper and the lower case. But he also has an important new teen in his life, and he's ready to learn and at a more even keel with the rest of his classmates. We've been serving about 18 little ones, and I really want to grow this to scale to meet the need. And so this summer we served more than 70, and District 65 identified over 180 rising kindergartners that could have used this extra help. And so my hope is to grow it to scale so that every little one who could use a little extra attention, we can help.
Thank you. I don't know if we've got any questions for the library. Karen, thank you so much for sharing what's going on at the library, sharing a little bit about the funding. So again, everyone, we're here at the Morton Civic Center talking about our 2017 proposed budget. You've heard from all of our department directors at this point this evening, and now we're going to, before we wrap up, talk a little bit about why we do all this and what our hopes of we have all the money allocated, all the various departments working together. What are we trying to accomplish? And what we're trying to accomplish is create the most livable city. And we're starting a new initiative this year, taking some work that we've already done with the STAR Communities program and really building on that. And Catherine Hurley, our sustainability manager, is here to talk a little bit about how we kind of pull all this together, how we kind of measure what we do in order to show the residents and the city council how we are making an investment of these precious tax dollars. So Catherine, thank you for holding out into hour three of our event. But why don't you talk a little bit about this Managing to Livability initiative we've just launched.
Sure, good evening. So as you can see on the slide, the livability theme has been part of Evanston's core for a very long time. Dating back to 2006, the last time the city and the community really did a strategic plan, creating the most livable city in America was the strategic vision for the city. And so much of the work that the departments are doing, our great community partners are doing, in one way or another, is connected in to that. But as any good plan goes, people move on, the initial documentation of something is less prevalent in your mind. And so recently, staff has been trying to sort of revive that effort around tracking and measuring and working towards the livable city vision. More recently, in 2014, as the city manager said, Evanston was one of the first 20 communities to go through the STAR rating system, STAR standing for Sustainability Tools for Assessing and Rating Communities. And it evaluates performance of communities on not only environmental factors, but also social and economic factors. And Evanston received a 4 out of 5 star, one of the top achievers in the process, national excellence. And as staff reflected on our evaluation and our self-assessment, really, one of the things that came to mind was the importance of understanding that all the work that our individual departments and our community partners and our schools do all helps to contribute to this idea of a livable city. There are 7 areas in this framework that really help to articulate what that's about. So before moving on to continuous improvement and what to do next, actually staff took some time to educate ourselves and talk about and explain how each department's individual role, from we talked about collecting meter revenue earlier, the great work that the library and Parks and Rec, our Health and Human Services, every department, even individual customer service representatives, they're helping to make Evanston a livable city. So we took some time internally to talk about all the work that we do and really learn about the facets, and then moving forward, working on that continuous improvement effort. So the managing to livability, the old adage is that you can't manage what you can't measure. So looking more seriously at all the things that are in our budget document every year, we have lots of performance measures, we have measuring our individual actions across departments. How can we look at all that information and look at it on a more frequent basis and try to figure out what's most important to collectively work on? So on this slide, the process that we're going to be going through, we've already started, is to take a look at all that information that we have. We have many wonderful plans across all different departments with community partners. We have our boards, committees, and commissions. What are all that great effort and work that's already been out there, already being worked on? And what are some of the most important things to both measure in terms of our progress to make a livable community, as well as what are some collaborative efforts that the departments can work on? But in order to kind of get out of our regular thinking process and stretch ourselves a little, rather than meeting by individual department, as we've heard from the great departments this evening, we're going to be meeting and are meeting across each of the livability areas. So this slide shows the 7 areas. We have the built environment, climate and energy, education, arts and community, economy and jobs, equity and empowerment, health and safety, and natural systems. So members of every department across all these areas are convening to talk about what are we measuring, as well as collaborative projects. And what's really been fascinating so far, we started with health and safety, and then we did economy and jobs. And so we have representatives from every department coming together and looking at what individual departments we're measuring and seeing how much overlap there is in things that we all want to know how we're doing in terms of progress, and then identifying projects that we can work on together, many of which are already in our guiding documents and are sort of low-hanging fruit, things that are on the wish list. Wouldn't it be great if we could ramp up that program, and by having multiple departments work together, that's what we're hoping to accomplish. So between now and the end of the year, we're gonna be convening meetings with staff in each of these areas and coming up with a shorter list of community scale outcomes, as well as actions we're going to measure, and then collaborative projects. So it's exciting to see departments be convening on topics that sometimes economic development division has a lot of responsibility on economy and jobs, and so does Parks and Rec, but actually we found that all departments have a stake and are actively working on things that are contributing to a strong and healthy economy.
So how will this fit into budgeting? While I think we're doing this as sort of a starting point for 2017, what's the vision to have this incorporate into the larger budget process for 2018 and beyond?
So I think, as was stated previously, a lot of our city budget is actually personnel, right? And so we have a limited amount of non-personnel dollars, but we do have personnel dollars. And so by looking at collaborating across departments, we can hopefully help use those staff dollars we've already invested. And by thinking ahead of time how departments can work together with their own resources, we're hopefully helping to have those dollars even take us further, because rather than three individual departments work on their own education and outreach strategy, working together to deliver a more comprehensive strategy to the community will make a more efficient use of resources. We can stretch them that way. And then the non-staff resources, we've also found that we have similar goals, but maybe we're thinking about them by ourselves. So in the future, departments contacting one another and saying, you know, I'd really like to ramp up this program. Could we partner, connect a grant resource that's maybe only available to public health departments if we tie in some health connection to the library ABC boosters, for example? So creating new and different ways of partnering that can maybe unlock some resources, as well as getting departments across department to talk ahead of time, rather than only thinking, okay, in my department, this is my bottom line, and I'm trying to work with that. If three or four departments put a little pool of money together, the result could be much bigger and better. So hopefully next year we'll be actually talking about this kind of process again and actually saying, well, what kinds of resources could we put together for budgeting for 2018?
That's great. So there's a method to the madness, that this is where we're trying to, you know, channel the work that you've heard tonight from all of our departments in a way that makes us a more livable community. We think this system is a very positive one, and we're going to continue to work moving forward in 2017 and beyond. So, Catherine, thank you for joining us this evening. So, Mr. Lyons, it's 9:15. We have about 62 slides left to go through.
Budget calendar.
Well, let's at least try to move forward with some of them from just past this, talking about municipal revenue sources. Again, I think this is kind of just a general overview. Property tax is 24.5%. Mr. Lyons, I think we both hear from people all the time in the community, I pay my property taxes and I expect a full complement of services. Well, the reality, for better or worse, is that the property taxes only pay for 25% of our full complement of services.
And before we put the pensions in the general fund, because that's when that's 17 million of the 27 million is just for pensions. So before that went in there, it was $11 million out of 96. So we were closer to 12 or 13% before we moved pensions into the general fund, were paid out of property taxes.
But then you look at the other tax number, that's a very large number, and I think really speaks to a whole variety of different kinds of taxes that we have. Well, we don't need to jump ahead, but there you go. So the sales tax between what we get from the state and our home rule, $16 million in sales tax. Athletic context tax, we love to say we're the only Big Ten school community that collects a tax on both basketball and football tickets. Mr. Lyons and I met with our colleagues from around the Big Ten, and we couldn't always resist saying that because
they also don't get permits.
They also don't get permit fees. So when you look at those other tax dollars, those are significant numbers. So let me go back to the slide. So we were at the budget overview. The next slide talked about the property tax. So needless to say, the city of Evanston does not get all of the property tax. And as you look at this, it's 18.1% of every dollar in property tax spent by residents in Evanston. The city sees 18.1%, District 65, 37.7, 202, 27.26, and then a cavalcade of other government entities from the Mosquito Abatement District on receives taxes there. This slide talks about the city's percentage share of property tax over a period of time. Goes to 1991. It's a sort of a tight frame, but from 21.7% of the property tax down to 18.62. So it is varied widely, but again, a relatively small portion of the property tax that's paid in Evanston comes to the city. Next slide. We've talked about that. That was the real estate transfer taxes. So, Mr. Lyons, what is a real estate transfer tax?
We assess a fee on the exchange of property in the city. So it is through a property transfer stamp. So when you must go to the clerk to get your stamp to do your closing. And this fee has varied greatly over time. We were up above $2 to $3 million prior to the 2008 bubble bursting. But as you can see, in the past 3 years, we have stabilized again at a very high level, and we do anticipate this continuing to be strong for one big reason, and that is how attractive our commercial property is. If you have one large building for $70 million or $60 million change hands, if you saw the newspaper article of the most expensive home being sold in Evanston
history, yeah,
was just under $5 million. But one of our large commercial properties could be 20 times that. And so they still have to pay that transfer stamp. And it is a good source of revenue that is, for the most part, in those transactions, there's somebody making a lot of money when that property is changing hands. So it's not that same burden that you see from a basic annual sales tax. So this has been something I think that has helped us in good times to have that stable source of revenue.
See, next slide. License permit fees, a whole variety again. We've talked about building permit fees, vehicle license fees, the wheel tax that is paid here. We are one of the few communities, perhaps the only community now in Illinois, that actually does not issue a sticker, but instead we use technology to read the license plates paid, cable franchise fees, and a whole variety of other fees. With that, building permits we've covered, fines and forfeitures, we've talked a little bit about that, and sort of the ping-ponging of that. Mr. Lyons, we were going from 3.2 to 3.5, so that's kind of a tight.
Well, what I'd like to point out is the 2016 number, the far right bar, is a budget number. That's what we had hoped to get. We will not get anywhere near that. We will be several hundred thousand dollars below that, because you can see the 2015 number is the lower number, and this is, we're going to get more money in meter revenues and less money in fines.
Next slide. Charges for services, and we've talked about many of these. We have an ambulance fee service, $1.5 million, the health inspection fee, alarm, registration fee, so every little bit counts.
The graphic is for our parks and recs, so that is the recreation fees. So we have kept those very constant, not trying to raise those. We've had a few increases, but trying to be respectful of letting everyone have access to all of our programs.
Next slide. Total expenses, all funds, that's a little bit hard to see, but you can see the general fund, $37.3 million, water, fleet, the total number varies from year to year depending on capital projects.
Yes.
But a little over $300 million for several years was $250 million. And there's a slide that talks about staffing. So, Mr. Lyons, let's see, we went down significantly during the recession, came back up a little bit over the last several years in FTEs, but still down from, 10 years ago, 884, so about 60 positions fewer than we were 10 years ago.
That stands for a full-time equivalents. So we might have 1,000 employees where 700 are full-time and 400 are part-time. So the FTE count is those all rounded up to even bodies.
Other funds, we probably could spend another 3 hours talking about some of these issues, but we've talked about water and sewer. We've talked about our water sales. We're talking with additional communities for that. Next slide. Motor fuel tax fund, emergency telephone, economic development, all pieces to our larger budget puzzle. Next slide. The insurance fund, Mr. Farrar touched, I think, on many of those major points. Next slide. Fleet services fund, we've touched on. Pension funds, we've touched on. Library, we've touched on. Capital projects, again, another big piece of what we do. $55.1 million in capital projects for the current year, streets, water, sewer. $18.8 million. We're doing a lot of street projects this year. Sheridan Road, Emerson Ridge, Green Bay, water main replacement, sewer line replacement, parks, facilities, water plant, significant dollars with capital. I think we try to balance, as Mr. Lyons has indicated, issues of debt versus need, and I think that will be issues we'll have to grapple with as we move forward. Next slide.
One of the things I do want to put in here is that we've had capital plans that vary between $30 and $50 million for the past several years, but this is the first year where we're going to execute upwards of 80% to 90% of those plans, and plans can be delayed for a variety of reasons. But we've had both a good budget and good execution during 2016 in getting a lot of these projects done, and so that's a great kudos to the change with Mr. Stonebeck and the Public Works Agency.
Next slide. Future budget sessions. So where are we in the calendar of events? We are at point two. We did a mid-year budget report to the City Council in August. Our current year budget is in pretty good shape, all things considered. No state budget, I think, probably turns out to be a good thing. The multimedia budget outreach event is concluding this evening. The proposed budget is scheduled to go before the City Council on October 7th. That will be posted on our website. We will then have a budget presentation to the City Council on Monday, October 17th and Monday, October 24th. There will be opportunities for public comment as part of those two City Council meetings. But the full public hearing on the budget will occur on Saturday, October 29th from 9 to 1. Usually those meetings end a little bit earlier than that. And then on Monday, November 7th, budget discussion. Monday, November 28th, we hope to have the budget adopted as well as the tax levy. Many different holiday events we have to work around, the Jewish holidays, Columbus Day, Thanksgiving, and so those are all noted. Excuse me, for your information.
Bless you.
I think that takes us to our last slide. There are a couple of final questions. One, for the police department, are there any violations that are being handled by Skokie Court that they could be managed by administrative hearings? Chief Eddington? Excuse me.
Not really. We're have maximized what we can bring into administrative adjudication. And there are other areas we continue to explore, but right now, under our current ordinances, we are maximizing the issues we can bring before the administrative judge.
Thank you, Chief.
Thank you.
And then a question regarding the James Park water issues. We continue to work on those matters. We've had a couple different public meetings. There's information on our website regarding the James Park matter. We have, I think, pretty thoroughly evaluated and discussed in other venues of the issues there, so I don't know that we need to do that other than to say, we, as Mr. Farrar mentioned, we are continuing a litigation with our large area utilities, and we hope to see a conclusion to those discussions here shortly. So that takes us through the questions, that takes us through the presentations. I want to thank the city staff that's here, Patrick Denon and Martha Logan from our Community Engagement Division. Thank you for getting this out on Facebook and Twitter. Ina Sanchez from our City Manager's Office, thank you for your efforts tonight. Kimberly Richardson, the Assistant to the City Manager, thank you. And Alex Thorpe from our Finance Division, kind of running the budget shop these days, and Ashley King's absence over the last couple of weeks. So thanks to all of you for your help this evening. Thanks to our department directors for your complete and thorough discussions of the issues. And we thank the members of the community that have joined us this evening, those of you who are following us electronically. Budgets are hard. Budgets in Evanston, budgets in Illinois are hard. We're committed to making sure that the residents of Evanston understand what those issues are, have as many opportunities to provide input as possible. Hopefully, we've certainly heard some things here tonight in the areas of affordable housing. I know that we're addressing in the budget Ms. Thomas-Smith talked about some issues on the township side, which we're going to be addressing in the budget. But there are still opportunities. Certainly, we can all be reached here through 311 here at the Civic Center. If people have additional questions, they can certainly still post them to Facebook or Twitter. Contact us through 311. We'll still have them. We're committed to as much transparency as possible with the budget process, and we hope that this evening's sort of different approach provided information that might not otherwise be provided. So again, my thanks to all the staff, Mr. Lyons, as well. My thanks to everyone who's helped with that. Thank you for tuning in, and have a good evening.